Welcome back, Ranger Nation. Hope everyone's staying warm. I'm Docker Hobb, and Ranger News starts now. Northwestern's online nurse practitioner program is one of the top in Oklahoma. Out of 763 online nurse practitioner programs in the country, Northwestern Oklahoma State University's program was named the 31st best and was the only Oklahoma nursing school in the listing. That's a pretty big deal. Evaluated by affordablecollegeonline.org, the criteria used for ranking included affordability, quality, flexibility, and the program. After scoring each criterion for Northwestern, affordability was the highest weighting factor that was ranked. The most impactful data points for affordability were tuition and grants. For quality, graduation and acceptance rates. For flexibility, part-time enrollment options. And for program, degrees granted in that specific program area. Here's Dr. Patricia Thompson, practicing family nurse practitioner and DNP program director, to tell us more about the program and what it means to Northwestern.
So when the program was developed and funded by the Wisdom Foundation and the Share Family Trust, what they decided to do was to develop a doctoral program that would develop nurse leaders and ask family nurse practitioners to go ahead and provide what we call primary care in clinics to the people of Oklahoma. When they developed the program, and I say they, this preceded me coming, they set the cost, and we are the only state university that has a BSN to a DNP program. There is a BSN to DNP program at University of Tulsa and also at the Kramer School of Nursing, Oklahoma City University. Both of those are private, and they are almost triple the cost of Northwestern. And so that is what has really attracted students. It's affordable, and they can work part-time or full-time while they're in the program. The entire program was developed by Dr. Shelley Wells, with that in mind, that we would meet the needs of rural Oklahomans. In terms of the benefit to Northwestern, not only increased enrollment, but I think it's kind of a claim to fame for Northwestern or North Central Oklahoma, and the fact that we have a rural focus, which both the Tulsa and the Oklahoma City programs do not, is really probably going to put us on the map in terms of graduate nursing education in Oklahoma. Additionally, there are some online nursing programs nationally that have many students in, like 350. They don't get the individual attention that we give to our students. I think one of the things that our students would say is that we are really responsive to them. So it's a really exciting time, and the students are excited about taking care of real patients, real live patients, and get out of the books and into the hands-on stuff.
Up next, Megan has highlights from an exciting week of Ranger Athletics. We'll be right back. I see your dirty face, hide behind your collar. What is done in vain? Truth is hard to swallow, so you pray to God to justify the way you live a lie, live a lie, live a lie. And it takes you all the time.
And now sports.
Welcome back, Ranger Nation. I'm Megan Meharry, and here's a glance at Ranger sports. The Northwestern football team faced off against that school down south on Saturday. Here's NWTV7 reporter Colton Fishback with highlights from Northwestern's last game this season.
Emotions were high as Northwestern squared off against their rivals down south in a 35-14 victory. It was the final game of the season, and for 14 dedicated seniors, it was the last time they would play the game they loved. Southwestern took the early lead on a block punt coming in the first quarter. The Rangers controlled the game after that moment, earning over 400 yards on offense and 20 first downs with explosive plays coming throughout the contest. Senior Horatio Smith created a spark when he returned a punt for a 75-yard touchdown. Quarterback Isaiah Weed had a great game for the Rangers, throwing for nearly 200 yards and two touchdowns when connecting with Justin Kane and Gavin Gardner. Freshman Tyson Gatewood made an impact, carrying the ball for another 100-yard rushing game. The Rangers' defense was led by senior Dakota Driscoll. The dominant linebacker gave the team momentum when he returned an interception 30 yards for a touchdown. Northwestern finished their 4-7 season on a high note, beating the Bulldogs on senior night and home.
The Ranger men's basketball team kicked off their 2018-19 season this last weekend in Tahlequah, where they competed in the MIAA GAC Basketball Challenge. They played two games over the course of the weekend. Their first game was against the Broncos from the University of Central Oklahoma. Despite the 26 points dropped by redshirt senior Joseph Moore, the Rangers fell to the Broncos 80-88. Their next matchup was against the Northeastern State Riverhawks. Trayvon Andres led the Rangers with 20 points, but the Rangers fell in the end 73-80. The Lady Rangers basketball team also took place in the MIAA GAC Basketball Challenge this last weekend in Tahlequah. They faced off first against the University of Central Oklahoma Lady Broncos. The Lady Rangers had a tough time getting anything going in their first game as they fell 53-64. The Lady Rangers bounced back the next day with a vengeance, however, as senior Kalia King led the Rangers to a victory against the Lady Riverhawks of Northeastern State with 20 points. The Lady Rangers won 76-71. The Lady Ranger volleyball team faced off against number one Harding in the first round of the Great American Conference Tournament in Hot Springs, Arkansas. The Lady Rangers held on until the very end, falling to Harding in five sets. After falling in the first set, the Lady Rangers bounced back to win sets 2 and 3 and then fell again in the fourth. The fifth and final set came down to the wire as the Lady Bison took the win 15-13, ending the Lady Rangers season. Hannah Williams and Jennifer Eubanks led the team with 15 and 13 kills respectively. The Lady Rangers finished their 2018 campaign with a record of 18 and 14 overall. Congrats to the team on a great season. That's it for sports. Up next, we have Montana McCullough with results from last week's Election Day. What's going on, Ranger Nation? I'm Montana McCullough, and here's a look at the midterm election results this far. The United States Senate has been taken over by the Republican majority, with 52 seats going to the Republicans and 47 going to the Democrats. There's only one seat still up for their entire votes, and that would be in the state of Florida. Now, on the House side, it's all Democrats, with them having 223 seats to the 197 that the Republicans hold. And also another thing going on nationally, the Florida governor's race is still on a recount because that the race was so tight at this time that I'm reporting this. And here's a look at a little bit more detailed on the national results.
With the midterm election results almost completely counted, there has been a huge shift of power in Washington, D.C. The Republicans still hold the Senate with 52 seats to the 47 seats that Democrats hold. But the Democrats have taken over the House of Representatives with 225 seats to the 197 that the Republicans hold. Here is a panel from CNN to talk about all the new diversity that is coming into the House of Representatives.
Michigan can win in Pennsylvania, can win in Ohio. We have the first Muslim women, first Native American women, of the first black woman from Massachusetts, first Latina from Texas. It may not be a blue wave, it's a rainbow wave. It's something happening.
And the day after midterm elections, President Donald Trump got up in front of several members of the media to talk about how huge of an impact it is that the Senate is still run by the Republicans.
It was a big day yesterday, an incredible day. And last night, the Republican Party defied history to expand our Senate majority while significantly beating expectations in the House.
Chuck Todd, who is a member of the NBC News crew, also talked about the recount that was possible at this time that I'm reporting in the state of Florida.
Florida recount. Any chance the outcomes are changed here by these recounts?
Boy, I tell you, I've never seen a recount. I've never seen someone overcome 12,000 votes in a recount, which is approximately what Bill Nelson would have to overcome, let alone the approximately.
In state political news, Kevin Stitt won the governor's race with almost 55%, going up against his opponent, Drew Edmondson. And in the Oklahoma lieutenant governor's race, Matt Pennell defeated Anastasia Pittman with almost 62% of the votes. In the state Senate, Republicans won with 39 seats over the 9 seats that Democrats have. And in the House, 75 seats went to Republicans, while the other 25 went to the Democrats. And here's a little bit more on how the state politics went.
And it just wasn't national midterm election results that affected the state of Oklahoma. We also voted on a new governor, lieutenant governor, state representatives, and House of Representatives. Kevin Stitt ended up winning the governor's race with a little over 54% of the votes. The lieutenant governor's race was won by Matt Pennell with almost 62% of the state votes. Maggie Carlo of KOCO5 got the chance to talk with Dr. Christine Pappas, a political science professor at East Central University, and Dr. Jeanette Mendez, the interim dean of political science at Oklahoma State University, to see what their opinions were on the political races from the midterm elections.
Over that we saw in 2010, and obviously with Governor-elect Stitt coming in, we saw quite a strong showing there. And then every statewide race, obviously Republican, every district attorney Republican. And so basically a continuation of that. That's what I see.
Oklahoma made some really big gains with women. And so I think that's going to be important to know. I think not just Kinder Horn, but we had many women run for office and be successful. And I think we saw that nationwide as well. And so it's always nice to hear Oklahoma is being talked about in terms of what's going on in politics. And that was on the radar. I think voter turnout was high, and I think that's important.
And that's a look at your nationwide and statewide midterm election results. Stay right here for more Ranger News.
Every day I'm shuffling. Yeah.
And back on campus, Northwestern held its annual Thankathon to help show gratitude to our many donors. Here is Capri Gar with more.
I'm Capri Gar with NWTV7, and this is the annual Thankathon.
The annual Thankathon is an event where students come together to thank donors of Northwestern. Club members, athletes, and any other students are welcome to come and write thank you cards and make phone calls to personally thank everyone who contributes to Northwestern.
This year is going great. Lots of students are showing up to say thank you, writing thank you cards, making phone calls, just saying thank you to our donors for everything they do for us. Lots of pizza, lots of goodies, lots of candy, and lots of thank you card writing.
These donors are who pay for many students' educations through scholarships. This is Northwestern's way of personally thanking everyone who contributes and carries on that Ranger spirit.
I'm Rupert Gar with NWTV7. Back to you in the studio.
And thanks for joining us this week, Ranger Nation. Make sure to tune in next week for our last newscast of the semester. Have a good one.